Greetings to all of you. Greetings to all of our brothers and sisters. Thank you so much for joining us tonight for a Monday, Thursday night service for the First United Methodist Church of Oroville. Tonight is the night in which our Lord Jesus Christ commemorates the Last Supper with his disciples. Tonight is the night in which he washed his disciples' feet to set an example for them that they are to serve one another. It is also on this night that he gave them a new commandment, to love one another as he has loved them. It is also on this night that he was betrayed. It is also on this night that he was arrested. This is the night before the crucifixion. And so as we come together tonight to reflect upon these things and to remember all that he has done for us, I ask you, so please join me in prayer at this time. Lord, bless us at this moment. Bless us at this time. Bless us on this night as we come together. We come together to reflect on what happened on this Thursday night, thousands and thousands of years ago. Lord, as we remember these things and as we reflect upon these things, may your Spirit lift us up. May your Spirit be with us and allow us to see the suffering of your Son, Jesus Christ. Allow us to be in fellowship with him through his passion and through his suffering. So, Lord, we lift up this night to you. We lift up everyone who joins us on this night for this service up to you. In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. And at this time, I would like to invite you to join me for the call to worship. Tonight, come and look upon the Lord. Jesus said, I give you a new commandment, that you love one another. On this day, Christ our Savior gave us this holy feast, that we who eat the bread and drink the cup may proclaim his holy sacrifice and be partakers of his resurrection, and at the last day may reign with him in heaven.
Do you really believe that one man can bear the full burden of sin?
Please shelter me, my Lord. My trust is in you. Be my refuge.
No man carry this weight alone. It is far too heavy. Saving men's souls is too costly. No one ever. No. Not ever.
Oh, Father. You can do all things. Let this chalice go from me. And let your will be done. Let your will be done, not mine.
else can touch my heart like you do. And I could search for all eternity long and find there is none like you. There is none like you. No one else can touch my heart like you do. And I could search for all eternity long and find there is none like you.
Exodus chapter 12, verse 1 through 14. The Lord said to Moses and Aaron in the land of Egypt, "This month shall mark for you the beginning of months. It shall be the first month of the year for you. Tell the whole congregation of Israel that on the 10th of this month, they are to take a lamb for each family, a lamb for each household. If a household is too small for a whole lamb, it shall join its closest neighbor in obtaining one. The lamb shall be divided in proportion to the number of people who eat it. Your lamb shall be without blemish, a year old male. You may take it from the sheep or from the goats. You shall keep it until the 14th day of this month. Then the whole assembled congregation of Israel shall slaughter it at twilight. They shall take some of the blood and put it on the two doorposts and the linen of the houses in which they eat. They shall eat the lamb that same night. They shall eat it roasted over the fire with unleavened bread and bitter herbs. Do not eat any of it raw or boiled in water, but roast it over the fire with its head, legs, and inner organs. You shall let none of it remain until the morning. Anything that remains until the morning, you shall burn it. This is how you shall eat it: your loins girded, your sandals on your feet, and your staff in your hand. And you shall eat it hurriedly. It is the Passover of the Lord. For I will pass through the land of Egypt that night, and I will strike down every firstborn in the land of Egypt, both human beings and animals. And all the gods of Egypt, I will execute judgment. I am the Lord. The blood shall be a sign for you on the houses where you live. When I see the blood, I will pass over you, and no plague shall destroy you when I strike the land of Egypt. This day shall be a day of remembrance for you. You shall celebrate it as a festival to the Lord. Throughout your generations, you shall observe it as a perpetual ordinance.
In the morning when I rise, in the morning when I rise, in the morning when I rise, give me Jesus, give me Jesus. Give me Jesus. You can have all this world, just give me Jesus. When I am alone, yes, when I am alone, oh, when I am alone, give me Jesus, give me Jesus, give me to die. When I come to die, when I come to die, give me Jesus, give me Jesus, give me Jesus, give me Jesus.
John chapter 13, verse 1 through 17 and 31b through 35. Now before the festival of the Passover, Jesus knew that his hour had come to depart from this world and go to the Father. Having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. The devil had already put it into the heart of Judas, son of Simon, to betray him. And during supper, Jesus, knowing that the Father had given all things into his hands and that he had come from God and was going to God, got up from the table, took off his outer robe, and tied a towel around himself. Then he poured water into a basin and began to wash the disciples' feet and to wipe them with a towel that was tied around him. He came to Simon Peter, who said to him, "Lord, are you going to wash my feet?" Jesus answered, "You do not know now what I am doing, but later you will understand." Peter said to him, "You will never wash my feet," Jesus answered. "Unless I wash you, you have no share with me." Simon Peter said to him, "Lord, not my feet only, but also my hands and my head." Jesus said to him, "One who had bathed does not need to wash, except for the feet, but it is entirely clean, and you are clean, though not all of you." For he knew who was to betray him. For this reason, he said, "Not all of you are cleaned." After he washed their feet, had put on his robe, and had returned to the table, he said to them, "Do you know what I have just done to you? You call me teacher and Lord, and you are right, for that is what I am. So if I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. For I have set you an example that you also should do as I have done to you. Very truly, I tell you, servants are not greater than their master, nor the messenger greater than the one who sent them. If you know these things, you are blessed if you do them." When he had gone out, Jesus said, "Now the Son of Man has been glorified, and God had glorified in him. If God had been glorified in him, God will also glorify him in himself and will glorify him at once. Little children, I am with you only a little longer. You will look for me, and as I say to the Jews, so now I say to you, where I am going, you cannot come. If I give you a commandment that you love one another, just as I have loved you, you also should love one another. By this everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another."
Hail, Rabbi. Judas, you betray the Son of Man with a kiss. Thank you.
1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 23 through 26. For I have received from the Lord what I also handed on to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took a loaf of bread. And when he has given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body that is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, he took the cup also after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes."
Please join me tonight for the prayer of confession. Most merciful God, we, your church, confess that often our spirit has not been that of Christ, where we have failed to love one another as he loves us, where we have pledged loyalty to him with our lips and then betrayed, deserted, or denied him. Please forgive us, we pray. By your Spirit, make us faithful in every time of trial through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Forgiven because you were forsaken. I'm accepted. You were condemned. And I'm alive and well. Your spirit is within me because you died and rose again. I'm forgiven because you were forsaken.
Amazing love, amazing.
Psalm chapter 116, verse 1 and 2, and verse 12 through 19. I love the Lord because he has heard my voice in my supplication. Because he inclined his ear to me, therefore I will call on him as long as I live. What shall I return to the Lord for all his bounty to me? I will lift up the cup of salvation and call on the name of the Lord. I will pay my vows to the Lord in the presence of all his people. Precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his faithful ones. O Lord, I am your servant. I am your servant, the child of your servant girl. You have loosed my bonds. I will offer to you a thanksgiving sacrifice and call on the name of the Lord. I will pay my vows to the Lord in the presence of all his people, in the courts of the house of the Lord, in your midst, O Jerusalem. Praise the Lord.
Greetings, brothers and sisters. If you have your United Methodist hymnal, please turn to page 9. That's page 9. And join me for the Thanksgiving and Communion. We'll be starting where it says the Great Thanksgiving. You'll be joining me where the letters are bolded. The Lord be with you and also with you. Lift up your hearts. We lift them up to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give our thanks and praise. It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father, almighty creator of heaven and earth. You formed us in your image and breathed into us the breath of life. When we turned away and our love failed, your love remained steadfast. You delivered us from captivity, made covenant to be our sovereign God, and spoke to us through your prophets. And so, with your prophets on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. Your Spirit anointed him to preach good news to the poor, to proclaim release to the captives and recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, and to announce that the time had come when you would save your people. He healed the sick, fed the hungry, and ate with sinners. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. When the Lord Jesus ascended, he promised to be with us always in the power of your word and Holy Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, pour out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice, in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them before us the holy before us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world until Christ comes in final victory, and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit and your Holy Church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. Because there is one loaf, we who are many are one body. For we all partake of the one loaf. The bread which we break is a sharing in the body of Jesus Christ. The cup over which we give thanks is a sharing in the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. Please join me. The body of Jesus Christ given for you. The blood of Jesus Christ given for you. Please join me for the prayer. It is on page 11 towards the bottom of the page where it says, Eternal God. Eternal God, we give you thanks for this holy mystery in which you have given yourself to us. Grant that we may go into the world in the strength of your Spirit to give ourselves for others. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
We are one in the Spirit, we are one in the Lord. We are one in the Spirit, we are one in the Lord. And we pray that our unity will one day be restored. And they'll know we are Christians by our love, yes, they'll know that we are Christians by our love. We will work with each other, we will work side by side. We will work with each other, we will work side by side. And we'll guard each man's dignity and save each man's pride. And they'll know we are Christians by our love, they will know that we are Christians by our love. We will walk with each other, we will walk hand in hand. We will walk with each other, we will walk hand in hand. And together we'll spread the news that God is in our land. And they'll know we are Christians by our love, they will know that we are Christians by our love.
At this time, I want you to think of a time. I want you to think of a time in your life when you felt the most lonely. Just close your eyes and just think about that. And as you're thinking about that with the music playing, I want you to write down some words that describes that loneliness. As you think about that, I'm going to give everybody about 5 minutes or so to just reflect upon that. Just a time in which you just felt the loneliness in your life. And just write as many words as you can. Just write them down to describe that. And if you would like, you can go ahead and just type those words into the comment section. You don't have to, but if you want to share with us, go ahead and share those with us. If you don't want to share with us, at least just keep those words with you. And so give us the next 5 minutes to do that.
Thank you.
You know, if you would like to share your stories with us, feel free to just type that into the comments section. If not, that's totally okay. But I just want you to really reflect upon that time. That time that you just feel so lonely, and just write those words down. Just write them down and just reflect upon them. When I often think of stories of loneliness, some of the stories that I often think about, being that I am a pastor and I have many pastor friends out there, one of the stories that I often think about, our children going to a new school. Many of my pastor friends, they're always being transferred to a new church. They're always being moved to a new city. They're always being moved to a new place. And so many times their children just doesn't experience that stable environment. And so they have to leave their friends, and they have to go to that new city, and they have to go to that new school. And as they go into that new school, they don't know anybody in that school. And the school just feels so big. It feels so large to them. They don't know where the classrooms are at. They don't know where the office is at. They don't know where the restrooms are at. And they spend so many time just trying to discover where their classrooms are at. They spend so much time just trying to discover who their teachers are. And not only that, many times they spend so much time trying to make new friends. And oftentimes, by the time they make those new friends, it's time for them to move already. And many times our pastor children, our PK, our pastor kids, many times they experience that loneliness in their lives because they're always constantly moving. I also think about families that have to move to a new city for whatever reason it may be. It may be because of a new job, and you just have to move your family to that new city, and you arrive at that new city and it's totally different from what you're accustomed to. I know stories such as these can be very, very lonely at times, especially when you're starting a new job and you don't know anything about that company that you are working for. And you're trying to establish yourself in that company. You're trying to establish yourself in that new environment. You're trying to learn about your boss. You're trying to learn about your co-workers, your associates. Be a lonely time. One of the things that's often close and dear to my heart are stories of refugees, because I myself was a refugee. I was too young to remember, but I often think about my parents' experience coming to this new country, leaving their homes, not by choice. They did not want to leave their homes. They wanted to stay in their homes. That's where they were born. That's the country where they were born. That's where they grew up in. That's the environment that they grew up in. But because of war, because of all this violence, because of persecution, they had to leave their homes to come to the United States, to arrive at a new country. And many times, many of our refugees, when they arrive here in the United States, they're often being sent away to live by themselves in a place in which they're not accustomed to. The whole purpose of this is trying to get them to assimilate into the country. And so many of our refugees are often sent away to live away from even their families, all for the purpose of trying to assimilate them. And I can only begin to imagine how difficult that must have been for them to leave their homes and to come to this country, a brand new country, an environment in which they have no knowledge about. Very, very lonely. But the very story that's probably closest to my heart is the story in which my mother tells me. It is her story. It is her story of being a young little girl, a young kid. And her father was sent away to war. Her father was sent away to war, to fight in the secret war, to fight in the Vietnam War. She waited for him, just wondering when he would ever return, only to find out one day that he has been killed in that war. and his body returns back to her. And some of the words that she uses to describe that feeling at that time, to describe how lonely she felt at that time. And Hwang, she often used the words such as brokenness. She describes a feeling of loneliness as being broken. She describes that feeling of loneliness as being sad. She describes it as just being totally helpless, being in total darkness. But probably the one word or the one description that gets to me more than anything else is the word of lost. Just feeling lost and feeling desperate at that time. And so we've all gone through times in our lives in which we just feel extremely lonely. And these words that my mother uses to describe her own story of loneliness, I believe these are words that we can often use to describe our own loneliness in our own lives too. You know, the Apostle Paul says, in Philippians chapter 3, verse 10, and he says that he wants to participate in the sufferings of his Lord Jesus Christ. And that's what I want us to be able to do here these next couple of days, starting tonight, is I want us to see the sufferings of our Lord Jesus Christ. I want us to see his loneliness, because it is tonight in which our Lord Jesus Christ, he was betrayed by Judas. But not only was he betrayed by Judas, we have to also realize that on this night, he was denied. He was denied by Peter, one of the disciples that was closest to him. Peter denied him three times on this night. It is also on this night in which he was deserted by his disciples. You know, oftentimes when we think about this night, we just think about Judas betraying Jesus Christ, but it was so much more than just Judas betraying him. It was the disciples deserting him at a time in which he was arrested and he was beaten and he was punished. I want us to think about this. I want us to reflect upon this. I want us to know in his suffering. I want us to understand how lonely he felt at this time. In Matthew chapter 27, verse 46, when he was nailed upon the cross, and as he was hanging on the cross, he said, "Father, why have you forsaken me?" I want to repeat that one more time. He says, "Father, why have you forsaken me?" And this is what I want to leave you with tonight. I just want to leave you with these words. I just want to leave you thinking about this as we participate in his sufferings on this night. And may the Lord be with all of you. And I look forward to seeing all of you this coming Sunday. God bless.
Everything is possible with God.